Final, source 9. Now, we already know, because of the title of the book, that maybe this guy's got an agenda. He's writing a book, British Butchers and Bunglers at World War I. Let's read what he says. For several reasons, it's surprising that the British Army, of all armies, was not the most advanced and eager in new tactical ideas. Straight away, it's not eager in new ideas. It doesn't, i.e., you know, it doesn't want to learn. It's comfortable with what it already knows. It's hardly going to be revolutionary change in the art of warfare if they're not eager for new ideas. The British Army had an ongoing history of small wars in which mobility was emphasised. The British were also furthest ahead in tank development. This should have done much to bring about tactical change. However, dull, inflexible senior officers stood firmly in the way of real change. Right, well, that's not a revolution in the art of warfare, is it? If they're dull and inflexible and they're standing in the way of change, the many lessons learnt at the front either didn't get back to the various senior staff or weren't acted upon. Well, there's a lot of evidence there that the Great War didn't result in a revolution in the art of warfare. But what's this source about? You've also got to think, what's the source about? This source is about leadership, primarily. Primarily, it's saying that the primary sort of thrust of the source is that the leaders stand in the way of change. So that challenges the view in the question. It says that there's no real change. It says that the leadership is to blame. But there's a slight ambiguity to source 9. It doesn't just say that. It also says, it does hint that maybe there were some developments, that it wasn't all backwardsness and resistance to change. It does say the British were furthest ahead in tank development. And that does suggest that maybe there was a revolution in the art of warfare. And it also ties in with what was said in Source 8. Source 8 says that there's a revolution in terms of technology, and it specifically says tanks. So does Source 9. And if you go back to the planning advice for the Florence Nightingale question, the second thing that you should do is look for links between the sources, i.e. do they corroborate? Well, there seems to be some corroboration there between sources 8 and 9. But other than that, I'm not sure I can see any other corroboration, really. This one is mainly about tactics. This one is mainly about technology. This one is about leadership. So there isn't really, that's really the only example of corroboration that I can see in these sources. The third step on this planning sheet was, when you've done this, you should have some views from the sources that you can base your essay paragraphs on. Now, the views from the sources that we got that we can base paragraphs on, well, we've got a view about tactics, we've got a view about technology, we've got a view about leadership. So I'm gonna start planning my essay now. I'm gonna write a paragraph on tactics. I'm gonna write a paragraph on technology. And I'm going to write a paragraph on leadership, because that's what the sources are suggesting. That's what the sources are about. And with these Unit 2 Part B essays, you've got to base your essay on what the sources suggest. You've got to deal with the evidence in them, but paragraphs should be about what the sources suggest. The fourth step. step on the planning that I gave you for the Florence Nightingale one was to consider how much weight you can give the evidence of the sources. You're not expected to comment on the views or reliability of secondary sources written by historians, but if there's a primary source, you should consider its provenance. Well, we did that. I've done that when I thought about the memoirs of Captain Kelly, so we thought about that. Step five is, you now need to think of what own knowledge you have to back up and develop the views from the sources, and you should make a note of this in your plan. Okay, this is my plan. What I'm going to do in the paragraph about tactics is say that there's some evidence that suggests there was a revolution in the art of warfare. And that evidence is in source seven. Now, what do I know from my own knowledge that I can add to that? Because in the marks scheme, you get marks if you look at level four the marks you get for AO1, which is knowledge. It says that there will be some integration between own knowledge and evidence gleaned from the sources. Whereas if you go down the mark scheme to the lower marks, there's less and less integration between the evidence of the sources and your own knowledge. Where some of you are going wrong at the moment is that you're including hardly any own knowledge. If you include hardly any own knowledge, you'll get hardly any, in fact, if any, of these 24 marks that are available. So there must be some own knowledge and you must try and integrate it. Now, what do we know about, what have we done in class about whether there was a revolution in terms of tactics? Well, when we looked at the Battle of the Somme, and when we looked at the third battle for Ypres, i.e. Passchendaele, and when we looked at the Hundred Days offensives, what we did in class was something like this. We looked at the tactics that were used, we looked at the leadership of those battles, and we looked at the technology used in those battles, and we looked for examples of good tactics, or not so good tactics, good leadership, not so good leadership, good use of technology, not so good use of technology. So, what tactics do we have, what do we know from our own knowledge that backs up the evidence of Source 7 that there was a revolution tactically? Well, what have we got here? Tunnelling for the Battle of the Somme. Right, okay. So I'm going to add that. There was tunnelling, there was mining, and counter-mining. There was an attack preceded by a heavy artillery barrage. It relieved the French at Verdun, it hardened the British army, it pushed the Germans really hard and perhaps helped their final victory, but there's not that much there in terms of sort of tactical revolution. Let's have a look at Passchendaele. Passchendaele, what I've got is that there was a creeping barrage that was used, i.e. rather than just a bombardment followed by infantry coming out of the trenches and going on the assault, the infantry came out at the same time as the barrage, walking just behind the shells that were falling. Well, that is an improvement in tactics. Maybe calling it a revolution is a bit much, but that is an improvement, so I'll talk about that. There was tunnelling and mining and counter-mining of the Somme. There was creeping barrage at Passchendaele. And what else? I haven't got an awful lot else for Passchendaele, because all I've got really is that the initial Lille, the losses were smaller and that shook the morale of the Germans, so not an awful lot there. But in my 1918 Hundred Days Offensive notes, I've got quite a lot. More use of surprise attack, more use of radio. Okay, so let's add that. In 1918, I'll add that in here on my plan. There's more surprise attack. More radio. Radio's technology, isn't it? So I won't include that. There's large scale tanks. Great integration with artillery. Okay, well, that's tactical, isn't it? Integration of tanks and artillery. What else have we got? More flexibility, starting second attacks instead of creating unwieldy salience as a result of the first, a succession of short jabs. Now, I don't know if you remember that from class, but what that means is that the attacks were launched in those 100 days offensives, then to try and sort of throw the Germans off balance, another attack was launched somewhere a bit further down the line, which would draw the Germans away from the position of the first attack. And then another attack would be launched somewhere else. You could call this like a boxer jabbing at various points of the line. And there's a sort of surprise element there. So we could talk about that as well. Starting second attacks. So I've got quite a bit of evidence from 1916 at the Somme, 1917 at Passchendaele, and 1918 that integrates with the evidence of Source 7 that there was a revolution in the art of warfare. So I'm definitely going to be able to write a paragraph about that.